at the start of the 90s, amid the polished perfection of pop and the glamour of hair metal. One band broke through and revolutionized the entire music landscape, creating a sound that was so raw and authentic that it completely changed the history of rock and roll. Ask any music fan where they were the first time they heard Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit, and they can probably tell you exactly how that revolution felt. Hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. I hope you're doing marvelously well. Welcome back to another episode of the series. If you haven't already, please subscribe. And if you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have a new video. And if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. Nirvana founding members Kurt Cobain and Chris Novoselic had met while attending Aberdeen High School in Washington State together.
Well, he was this weird kid, and I was a weird kid, and we thought the world was weird, and so we gravitated towards each other, and we loved punk rock music, and everybody else hated punk rock music.
The first band was actually a Creedence Clearwater Revival tribute band called The Sellouts, but by early 1987, they had launched a new band. Nirvana recorded a 10-song demo with Seattle producer Jack Endino, who then sent the demo to indie record label Sub Pop. After hearing their demo, Sub Pop co-founder Jonathan Poneman signed the group. Later that year, Nirvana recorded their first album, Bleach, which was released in June of 1989. While the record label did not extensively promote Bleach, it became a favourite in the college radio circuit, steadily selling over a long period of time. The band would go through several drummers in those early years, before finding Dave Grohl in 1990. In a 1991 interview with Studio Brussel, Cobain explained,
"Chris and I have been playing together for about 4.5 years now with a few different drummers, and Dave has been in the band for a year. This is the first time we've ever felt like a very definite unit. The band is finally complete."
In early 1991, Nirvana signed with DGC Records, who would release their second album, Nevermind, later that year. Some of the material had been written previously, prior to Grohl joining the band, when they were still under Sub Pop. In fact, some of them had even been recorded in producer Butch Vig's Smart Studios in Madison, Wisconsin. Vig, who had just finished working on the Killdozers album, 12 Point Buck, had been suggested to the band by Poneman, Vig recalled. Jonathan called up because he said he loved the sound of this Killdozer record. And he said, "I want you to get that sound for Nirvana. I wanted to work with Sub Pop because I knew they were a cool label." In these short sessions, the band recorded Pay to Play, Dive, Sappy, Here She Comes Now, and three tracks which would later appear on Nevermind: In Bloom, Lithium, and Polly. The Smart Studios recordings became like a demo for DGC Records to hear the band's developing sound. In the time between these sessions and the actual recording of Nevermind in May and June of 1991, the band further refined their performances. By the time they got into the studio, they were ready to create one of rock history's revolutionary albums. Nevermind as an album turned the whole rock world on its head. But one song in particular stands out for the way it brings together the band's punk attitude and the distorted sonic world alongside hauntingly beautiful melodies. And that song is Smells Like Teen Spirit. Smells Like Teen Spirit is an interesting song in many ways. Cobain credits the song's dynamic changes and sound to an attempt to imitate the Pixies. He was attempting to write the ultimate pop song. With the newly recruited Grohl on drums, the band quickly found their groove, writing and rehearsing the song together. They made a rough recording, which they sent to Vig, who was continuing as their producer even through the label change. Vig recalls hearing the first recording of the song, which is also the first time he heard Grohl play with the band on drums. Kurt introduced it by saying, "Hey Butch, we got some new songs for you, and we also got Dave Grohl. He's the best drummer in the world." Then they clicked into Teen Spirit, with the scratchy guitar at the start. It was so effing distorted, I could barely hear anything. But underneath the fuzz, I could hear hello, hello melodies and chord structures. And even though the recording was terrible, I was super excited. The next time Vic heard the song, it was in a rehearsal space. His response was visceral.
I remember standing up and pacing around the room. I couldn't believe how intense and how powerful they sounded. And there were no mics on Dave's kit, and the drums were just punishing sounding in the room. I mean, it was pretty amazing sounding. I remember literally breaking out into a sweat going, oh my God, this is incredible. And I didn't really know what to do when they finished, except I paused and said, that was really good, you guys. Play it again. And I just needed to let my brain digest it.
The guitar sound is definitely striking in its distortion and edginess. From the minute the guitar introduces the song, audiences realized this was a band that sounded completely different from the world around them. The way Cobain slides from chord to chord sounds raw and unrehearsed, and yet it is so perfectly executed. I love when you just hear that guitar pedal come down, guitars go wide. It just gets huge. It's so exciting. Listen to that again. Just the difference between the intro guitar and then the pedal coming on and the stereo guitars coming in. And listen to a little bit of verb on the intro guitar. The massive tempo change there is really, really exciting. So this is a great guitar part. I mean, the song is essentially one chord sequence all the way through, with the exception of the bridge. It's got that great screaming note in the bridge, that ah, that comes out of nowhere, which is really, you know, a signature part of Nirvana. And then so many bands afterwards would just kind of throw in a sort of random flat five or minor third bending and, you know, all kinds of weirdness. It was just, I used to hear bands doing it all the time. You know, because it's on the F sharp. So you got that. So what he's doing is he's bending the major third. And it's ugly. But before we get to that, one of the things I love about this track most is the fact that it's essentially one guitar part going all the way through. There are a couple of moments, like in the pre-chorus, where he's playing with drive and with the chorusing effect, where he's playing the... And that's playing at the same time that there's chords going. But that's the only time. The rest of it, even though the guitars are doubled, is just one continuous guitar part going all the way through. When he plays the lead part after the bridge, there's no supporting rhythm. So what does that mean? It means that when you went to go and see them live, it was a powerhouse because you just needed one guitar, bass, and drums. And with the fact that they were so dynamic on stage, it just, you know, with Dave Grohl just going absolutely nuts, it was one of the best live shows because it felt like the record because you had the visuals and the simple driving parts. I mean, one of the best live shows I've ever seen. So another thing that nobody ever talks about, which is quite interesting, is that the intro speeds up. So it starts off like this. So there's just that ramp up with Grohl coming in on the heavy, you know, when he goes down and presses the Boss DS1 distortion pedal. We don't have a small clone. We have the clone theory, which is like the big brother in electroharmonics. Apparently, Kurt liked the small clone, and I used to have one, and I know why, because it's got like one simple control on it. But it's great. These are obviously all power chords. Kurt would always play it with the third finger barring these two. Most people play power chords like this, but he would play like this. What you got that? Either works. I think sometimes there's some sort of interesting overtones from playing it like this that make it sound a bit more grunge, a bit more punk, a bit more angry. It's up to you, however you want to play it. And then, of course, you know, this part in the verses. And, you know, there's some sophistication to it if you want to analyze it like that, because, of course, so Chris is playing the F and, of course, the B flat and then the G sharp and the D flat. And that gives you the illusion of like an F5 chord. And then with the B flat, you get that 9. So it's like a B9. But of course, there's no major third. So I suppose it'd be a B sus 2 if you want to be pedantic. And then, of course, you've got the G sharp chord, which would give you the major third and the 6. And then lastly, you would hear the last chord as a D flat major 7th. But let's be honest, nobody in Nirvana was thinking, you know, those chords whatsoever. It's just purely all done by feel, emotion, and just the ear. They just loved hearing this going over the top of the. And another thing I think it's really important to remember when you're playing this kind of music, you want to play it in a really consistent, powerful way, which sounds really obvious. But if you listen to Chris's bass line, he's sliding around. So he's not going. It's not all nice and clean and 1-4, 1-4 like this. He's sliding around. And that energy, that movement as he's sliding around makes it even more powerful against Grohl's like absolute battering ram of massive drums. And then add the tension of that, and you get something really exciting. So the only other thing to really talk about is the bridge section, which is interesting because it's. It's just really, really cool. Now, he goes into the solo, which is doubled. It's got the distortion on it, plus it's got the really over-the-top, amazing chorus. Now, talking about how Chris is like moving around like on one string and all the slides is adding that energy, I really feel strongly that the solo is played the same way, entirely on the G string. I did watch a video of him playing. Every time he played it differently, and sometimes he wouldn't even play the solo at all. He would do just some random kind of, you know, noise stuff where he was like, which really added to the energy. When I saw them play in 92, that's what the solo was. It was just noise, but the whole crowd was going nuts. I mean, it was 70,000 people. So it worked and it made sense. But on the record, it sounds like it's sliding down to that G sharp. So once again, then. To the open G, the same thing again. And then mirroring the hello, 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 hello. So apart from that F, everything is on the G string. And it does make sense. I remember working with Dave Jordan. Obviously, he's Alice in Chains and other bands, but he really wanted us to always play parts on the same string as much as possible, so I have the consistent kind of roar that you get from just sliding around on the string. Makes a lot of sense with the bass. If you play everything on the low end, low string, it keeps the low end really, really consistent. Especially in like 91, nobody was using sophisticated, like, you know, dynamic EQs and multiband compressors controlling the low end or the whatever. You know, they wanted you to perform it in a way that sounded consistent. Everything about this song is phenomenal. The attitude in every single person's performance, all the parts are fantastic. Not to mention the incredibly hooky melody. I mean, it's a melody that anybody can sing along with amazing lyrics that just spoke to a very disenfranchised Generation X, which I can wholeheartedly understand because that's my generation. Anyway, this was a band that was really, really powerful for me and for many, many of our friends. Hugely, hugely important song. Of course, when Grohl's drums come in, it is clear that Nirvana had found the hardest sound they were looking for all along. The amazing thing about Grohl's drum part here is that even completely isolated without the guitar, bass, or vocals, you still know exactly what song you're listening to. The drums carry that much of the song's character. They are amazing. I love hearing the ring on that snare. Amazing. You know the song immediately. That way the drums come in is just huge. And then the groove in the verse is amazing. Novoselic's bass provides the song's underlying pulse, but there's actually more to it than you might think. Isolated, you can hear his slides across the bass, which definitely create the longing and the pull that gives this song its contradictory sense of being pulled back simultaneously as it pushes forward. He's also constantly changing up little rhythmic ideas in different sections of the song. The way that he's like sliding to those notes that just keeps it moving. It's got a really great push and pull groove along with the drums. Perhaps the most striking part of the song, however, is Cobain's haunting vocals, which carry such amazing melodic content amid such a hard, aggressive sound. This is a huge element of what makes this song and Nirvana so amazing. Here you have this hard-rocking grunge sound coming out of the Washington scene, a sound that takes punk's DIY aesthetic to a whole new level. And then they use that sound in conjunction with captivating melodies that just pull you in. Listen to Cobain's phenomenal performance as he sings the opening verse.
Load up on guns, bring your friends, it's fun to lose and to pretend she's overborn and self-assured. I know a dirty word. Hello, 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 hello.
This melody is so different and creative against a straightforward chord progression. And then when he goes into the pre-chorus, it's even more mesmerizing.
Hello, 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 hello. Hello, hello, hello.
double tracking of the vocals on this section and the chorus are much more obvious than in the verse, and it creates more power and mystery in the track. Despite it being a common practice in recording at this time, Cobain was actually very hesitant to double track his vocals. Vig recalled, "I said, Kurt, I want you to double track the guitars and vocals to really make this jump out of the speakers. He thought it was cheating, especially with his vocals. So I had him do multiple vocal takes, and he sang them so consistently, I could then run them at the same time as the double track, and it really made the song sound powerful." It actually took Vig reminding Kurt that John Lennon had done it in his recordings to truly convince him to try the practice. And it's a great thing that he did. When you hear Cobain's thick vocal sound on the choruses, it's clear that Vig was making the right choice.
With the lights out, it's as dangerous. Here we are now, entertainers. I feel stupid and contagious. Here we are now, entertainers. I'm a lotto, I'm a vino, I'm a skato, my libido. Yeah. Hey. Yay.
When we hear the song today, we have no problem reconciling the amazing craftsmanship of Cobain's writing alongside the band's grunge sound and DIY aesthetic. But in 1991, Cobain struggled with these contradictory elements. Vig explained, "I know that he felt conscious coming from a punk background and having these kind of gorgeously crafted rock songs. Even though his songs might have been kind of noisy, they still had really beautiful melodies and melodic structures. Smells Like Teen Spirit draws its title from a piece of graffiti written on the wall of Cobain's motel room by Bikini Kill lead singer Kathleen Hanna. Hanna recalled that she and her bandmate Toby Vale, who was dating Cobain at the time, were drunk, messing around in a grocery store in Olympia, Washington, when they came across a rack of Teen Spirit deodorant. Me and Toby were like, ooh, look at this, it's so crazy, it's called Teen Spirit. We were laughing, saying, your arm smells like Teen Spirit, or whatever. We were both joking around because the name looked so funny. I mean, who names their deodorant Teen Spirit? What does Teen Spirit smell like? Like a locker room? Like pot mixed with sweat? Like the smell when you throw up in your hair at a party?" With the phrase still stuck in her head, Hanna spent that evening hanging out with Cobain and Grohl. Later that night, she drunkenly wrote, with Sharpie on the wall of Cobain's motel room, "Kurt smells like Teen Spirit." Cobain thought the phrase sounded cool and called Hanna up to ask if he could use it for a song. "I was like, sure, I don't know why you'd want to call the song that, but fine. I just thought it was weird. He didn't know it was a deodorant. I felt like a bit of an asshole that I didn't tell him, but I kind of thought it was funny. He just liked the ring of it. Smells like Teen Spirit. But he also just had a good knack for picking out interesting phrases." The song's cynical lyrics are epitomized in the chorus, which begins, "Here we are now, entertain us." According to Cobain, "That came from something I used to say every time I used to walk into a party to break the ice. A lot of times when you're standing around with people in a room, it's really boring and uncomfortable. So I was like, well, here we are, entertain us. You invited us here." The song's music video also captures the angst and teen-inspired focus of the song. The video, directed by Samuel Bayer, features the band performing in a high school gym to anarchy, touting cheerleaders and apathetic teenage listeners. As the performance continues, the teens erupt into a scene of chaos. The music video was the perfect complement to Nirvana's takeover of the popular music landscape. It visually declared grunge's dominance and highlighted the changing aesthetic of the new generation. Smells Like Teen Spirit and the rest of the Nevermind album was recorded at Sound City Studios in Van Nuys, California. Vig, who had produced their first intended tracks for the second album in their Sub Pop days, continued with them after their contract was bought out by DGC Records. Despite the raw, unpolished sound that was championed by grunge bands like Nirvana in the early 90s, the group was actually very well rehearsed and prepared before they even entered the studio. They were psyched. As I started talking to them, they told me they were ready. They had been rehearsing every day for 3 months. There was definitely not a slacker ethic in the band. I mean, they wanted to make a great record. And Kurt was very ambitious, you know. When they walked into the studio, they were ready to go. In recording Smells Like Teen Spirit, Vic began with the bass and the drums, using 10 of the 24 tracks. Tracks 11 and 12 were used to record the band playing together live. The guitar was recorded in only 2 takes, with the first take being the primary performance we hear on the release. He used an electroharmonic small clone effect on the verse and pre-chorus of the guitar, which gives it that awesome chimey sound in the verse and that warbling crazy sound in the pre-chorus. The 3 vocal takes of Teen Spirit were combined and placed on track 15. Vig also asked Cobain to isolate his vocals just on the hello, 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 how low pre-chorus to create tracks 21 and 22. This step also allowed Cobain to move in closer to the mic and get that amazing performance.
Hello, 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 hello. Hello, 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 hello.
Let the lights out!
Vig and Cobain began mixing the song and the rest of the Nevermind album immediately after recording, but no one was satisfied. Andy Wallace, who had recently completed Slayer's Rain in Blood album, was then brought in as fresh ears to mix Nevermind. Novoselic recalls the experience positively, encouraged by the raw, aggressive sound they heard on the Slayer album. Wallace likewise says that the band responded well to his addition. Their main request was a big, thick sound. By the time we got started, they knew I was not going to bathe them in reverb and polish everything. They were mainly concerned with making sure there was plenty of bass. I was told to make the sound more thick and beefy, yet discernible. Vig and Wallace moved over to Scream Studios in Studio City to finish the mixes. The result is the now iconic balance of raw power alongside a clear commercial appeal. Smells Like Teen Spirit was released on September the 10th, 1991, as the lead single from the band's second album, Nevermind. The album followed 2 weeks later. The song was an immediate hit. 1 week before the album even being released, Nirvana was scheduled to play a performance at the Beehive Record Store in Seattle. They arrived to an overflowing, sold-out crowd that swarmed them, forcing them to escape to the tavern across the street while teenage fans, who weren't allowed into the over-21 tavern, snapped pictures of them through the window. When they finally made it to the store to begin their performance, it was clear that everyone already knew the song, and they were fully aware that they were witnessing rock history in the making. Smells Like Teen Spirit was an instant success on the college radio circuit, but it also became the unexpected crossover hit that took grunge mainstream. A couple of months after its release, the song hit number 6 on the Billboard Hot 100 chart, the same week that the Nevermind album hit number 1. It also hit number 7 in the UK, staying in the charts for 184 weeks. It was the year of Nirvana. topping both the Village Voice and Melody Maker's year-end polls, and hitting number 2 on the Best Singles of the Year list by Rolling Stone. It was nominated for 2 Grammy Awards, Best Hard Rock Performance with Vocal and Best Rock Song. The song catapulted Nirvana into mainstream success, forcing the reluctant Cobain into the undesired role as a spokesperson for Generation X. Cobain's tragic suicide in 1994 caused fans to dig even deeper into the song, which reveals some of rock's most poignant emotions of youth. Smells Like Teen Spirit has remained an iconic track in the history of rock, even inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame's list of songs that shaped rock and roll in 1997, only 6 years after its release. MTV and Rolling Stone listed it number 3 on their list of the 100 greatest pop songs, and NME named it number 2 on their greatest singles of all time. Rolling Stone's 2004 list of the 500 greatest rock songs of all time named Smells Like Teen Spirit number 9. It has been credited with transforming the 90s rock landscape, which had been previously dominated by hair bands and polished pop. It ushered in a new sound for rock and roll, a sound which was both revolutionary and somehow still apathetic, paralleling the band's signature contradictory sensibilities in their sound and songwriting. On August the 30th, 1992, I was at Reading Rock Festival. My good friend, Mr. Matt Butcher, was the controller. He was overseeing all the live sound. He was either mixing bands or he was helping out individual front of house mixers that were working with their bands. And I was lucky enough to go side of stage when Nirvana played, when Kurt famously came out, you know, in the wheelchair. He was wearing a smock from a hospital, and I think his hair was like in pigtails or something. All I can say, it was easily one of the most anticipated live performances I've ever been to, even remembering it. All of my hairs are standing on end. It was unbelievable. Everybody knew that Nirvana were going to play. Everybody was ultimately there to see them. And it was electrifying. The sound was huge. Grohl's drums were absolutely massive. I don't know what it is about the way he hits drums, but he just makes them sound 10 times bigger than any other human being. I know this from not just that experience, but our good friend Daryl Thorpe has said that. It's just, he knows how to make those things sing. The bass tones were massive. The guitars were enormous. And it was guitar, singular. This was a 3-piece band. And it was the biggest sound you could imagine. And one of the things I think we always have to remember about this band, about this massively influential band, was they wrote amazing songs. Kurt Cobain had an amazing sense of melody. He knew how to take chords and twist them and use different movements that had been done before, those minor third but major chord movements. All of that stuff was just different. But at the end of the day, they were a huge rock band with a punk attitude. Every player was phenomenal, and they wrote and played amazing songs. Thanks ever so much for watching. Please check out the other videos in this series. Leave any comments and questions you might have down below. Any suggestions about who else we might cover. And have a marvelous time. We'll speak to you all again soon. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, adios, tschüss, goodbye.